Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. Lickety-split, folks. That's how God works. All he's got to do, something pops up, he takes note of it, he just speaks the word, done. That's the kind of God I love. That's the kind of God we have. That's the God of the Bible right there. It says, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. I want to entitle this message tonight, He's Still God. He's Still God. I think songs have been written to that end, He's Still God. And no matter what we face, God is never going to lose his power. He's never going to lose his position because of anything that ever occurs in nature or anything that ever occurs in our lives or our family's lives. He's still God. And we need to be mindful of that. As I said before, this psalm is a song. And maybe even more than that, it's not just a little jingle that we sing. It's something that we need to be mindful of for whenever trouble comes our way. During times of distress and discouragement, when thoughts of God were a solace, a comfort to the soul, Martin Luther's "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Martin Luther, now we may not agree with all of his doctrine, but I'll tell you one thing I do agree with. I do agree with his desire to trust God in the midst of a storm. And this song has been called the greatest hymn of the greatest man of the greatest period of German history, and called the battle hymn of the Reformation. And this hymn was sung at the funeral of President Dwight Eisenhower at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. in March of 1969. Let me just go over it briefly for you. This is a mindset that it's one thing if God puts something out and we ought to receive it and accept it. No argument there. But when man, whoever the man or woman is, can know this to begin with and pen these words without inspiration of God, it's pretty impressive. And would to God that every one of us get to the place in our lives where no matter what goes on in our lives, we are of the opinion, like Martin Luther, God is a mighty fortress. And so the song says, a mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Buddy, don't forget it. Don't forget it. He's playing for keeps. The second stanza, did we in our own strength confide? I would quote Paul and say, God forbid. Our striving would be losing. We're not the right man on our side. The man of God's own choosing doth ask what that may be, Christ Jesus, it is He. Lord Sabaoth, His name from age to age the same, and He must win the battle. Third stanza, and though this world with devils filled should strengthen to undo us, we will not fear, for God hath willed His truth to triumph through us. The prince of darkness grim, we tremble not for him. His rage we can endure, for lo, his doom is sure. One little word shall fell him. Remember I said before, all God's got to do is say it. You got to love that. The last stanza, that word above all earthly powers, no thanks to them abideth. The spirit and the gifts are ours through him who with us sideth. Let goods and kindreds go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. A couple of days ago, I happened to see the news account. Throughout my life, I've been reminded of this annually on December 7th. It was the 76th year since the attack on Sunday morning of Pearl Harbor. And President Roosevelt said that it would be a day that would live in infamy. And it has. But I fear that as time has gone on, it has kind of just diminished and fallen off and into obscurity to where, sadly, I don't think with the passing of time and generations, I don't think there's probably a lot of young people that know a whole lot about that tragic incident. However, they have one that's replaced it, and that was September 11th in 2001. See, when Roosevelt said this day would live in infamy, he never envisioned that something worse could happen. But it has. And as much as we'd like to think that September 11th is the epitome of all storms and trials and devastation that will ever take place in our lives or in this country, I hope it is. But chances are, given time, something will surpass 9/11. And perhaps even Pearl Harbor combined. How long before we as a nation or as people weep again? I don't know. But surely, just as surely as we're here, another storm will come along. Another tragedy, another heartache will come. And we had better know that He is still God. He is still God. Now, I know all the gatesayers, they come along and say, well, if He was a loving God, why didn't He prevent these kinds of things? Hey, God was there all the time. And He always is there. And if man would just simply cling to Him, I think the storms of life would be, could be, should be more enduring. Let me give you some things regarding the fact that He's still God. In our text here, in Psalm 46, let me say in the first three verses here, we see God's power. God's power. Look at verse number one. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. His power is limitless. His power is eternal. His power is without match. In Psalm 59 and verse 16 and 17, the Bible said, but I will sing of thy power. Yea, I will sing aloud of thy mercy in the morning, for thou hast been my defense and refuge in the day of my trouble. Unto thee, O my strength, will I sing, for God is my defense and the God of my mercy. Now, clearly, many of the Psalms are, well, clearly this is Israel's songbook. And so Israel has a direct relationship to the events that take place in here, both in their historic respect, in Israel's past, but certainly in their future. And no doubt they'll be singing these things through the tribulation as well. A time that Jeremiah wrote of Jacob's trouble. trouble that's going to come on Israel, such as the world has never seen. Jesus described it to that extent that the world has never seen, nor ever will see again. And so I think if we were to look at that, we could recognize the fact that if Israel, or anyone for that matter, could sing during those things and claim the power of God, what about our storms? What about the things that we go through? Talk about trouble. Alas, again, Jeremiah 30 and verse number 7. Alas, for the day is great, so that none is like it. It is even the time of Jacob's trouble, but he shall be saved out of it. He shall be saved out of it. You know, folks, Paul said, out of them all, speaking of all the trials, all the troubles that came his way, he said, the Lord delivered me out of all of them. And so Matthew 24 and verse 21, Jesus said that there would be great tribulation. And I think as time goes on, every one of us has had our bumps in the road, some to a greater extent than others. And I'm not trying to doctrinally redefine what this passage is dealing with, but simply to apply it to the things that we go through in life. And if it will work for the greatest tragedy that human beings will ever experience on the face of this earth, then I think it'll work for the next flat tire that we get. I think so. Not only does Israel need God's power in a time of trouble, but so do we. Sometimes, don't you just feel a little powerless? Ephesians 1 and verse 17 to 19 says that the God of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, what the riches of the glory of the inheritance of the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe. I want to know, I have seen demonstrated, not necessarily in have I been the recipient of all of this endlessly, but I, for what I haven't seen with my own eyes in my own life, I've seen in other people's lives. And I said, wow, man, that's still God. God is still on the throne. He's still God. And he's our refuge in our strength. God is our defense. He's our offense. He's the one that fights the battles. He's the one that says, stand still. You know, just sit back and watch this. Watch the power of God. In Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 18 and 19, we're told that by two immutable things in which it was impossible for God to lie, we might have a strong consolation. And that's what we need. We need God's word, what he has said and what he's written. That is the strong consolation that we have, who have fled for refuge to lay hold on the hope set before us. He said, which hope we have as an anchor of the soul. And then he said, it's both sure and steadfast. And folks, it needs to be, and it can be, and bless God, let's allow it to be. Let's stop fighting the battles ourselves, and let's turn it over to God. Let's let him specialize in the things that he specializes in. And for the nation of Israel, God provided cities of refuge in order to flee from the avenger of blood. And we're not looking for a city. I know Abraham was looking for a city whose builder and maker is God, but I'm not looking for a city. I'm looking for a Savior. I'm looking for a person, Jesus Christ. And three times in the Psalm that we've read, in verse 1 and verse 7 and verse 11, we're told that God is our refuge. God is our refuge. He's trying to drive home the point. And not only is our refuge, but he's also our rest. Jesus said, he that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. So it's not like you're going to run to get help from somebody and they're going to say, no, I can't help you. Get out of here. In Matthew 11 and verse 28 and 29, Jesus invited, he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. He said, take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly of heart, and ye shall find. He didn't even say you might. He said, ye shall find rest unto your souls. Hebrews 13 and verse 6 says, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, and I will not fear what man can do unto me. And so the first thing that I see here in this psalm about he's still God is we see his power. And I think there's a tendency for us to recognize that if you're going to seek help from someone, you want to know that they have the power to do something. You're not going to seek out somebody that's weak and frail and sickly. And I mean, you just can't have a whole lot of confidence in that. But we see God's power. And then secondly, we see God's presence. God's presence. It says there in verse number 5, in the midst of her. In the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Well, he's still God. He's still God. And that's a consolation. God shall help her. God shall help her. The song says, what he's done for others, he'll do for you. Isaiah 41 verse 10 says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. He said, I will strengthen thee, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Isaiah 41 and verse 13 and 14, for the Lord thy God will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. Fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee, saith the Lord thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Isn't it good when someone says, I'll help you, I'll help you, I'll help you. And you think, well, what are you going to do? Well, we already know there's nothing that God can't do. Is there anything too hard for the Lord? 2 Corinthians 1 and verse 5 says, for as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also aboundeth by Christ. And not only does his presence give us this consolation, but it gives us a great comfort as well. In verse number 7 of our text, it says, the Lord of hosts is with us. Not only is he with us in our surroundings, but he's with us inside of us. Everywhere we go, we take him along the way. In Matthew 1, in verse 23, the Bible said, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. Why is that? Because it's interpreted as God with us. Think about that. We're not talking about just a religious leader. We're talking about God with us. Psalm 46 and verse 11 says, the Lord of hosts is with us. John 14 and verse 16 to 18, Jesus said, I'll pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you forever. With you forever. Even the Spirit of truth. Jesus went on to say in verse number 18, he said, I will not leave you comfortless. I will come unto you. And boy, I'll tell you, he has done that over and over and over again. Our God is not only still on the throne, but he's still God. And he always will be. When we see this psalm, we recognize two things thus far. We see God's power and we see God's presence. But then when you do that, the end result of that is peace. Or at least it should be. Once you've gone that way, once you've recognized who God is, once you've made your move in that direction, recognizing the power that he possesses, and you realize the proximity of which he is, where he's with us, then that ought to give you a peace. The peace of God that passeth all understanding. Again, he's still God. Now, we know that Jesus, they marveled at this. He'd be in a ship, and these seafaring men thought they were going to die, and they wake Jesus up. By the way, he was sleeping through it. He wakes up, and they're crying out, carest thou not that we perish? And all he does is stand up and say, peace, Be still, and everything calms down. Now, I'm not telling you that God is going to do that every time a storm arises in your life, but if he chose to do it, it would end just like that. But there are so many reasons why God allows us to go through storms. Sometimes it's to make us a little tougher. Sometimes it causes us to trust him a little more. But I know this, Jesus said in John 14:27, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth unto you." He said, "Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid." The kind of peace that God gives us is one that takes great comfort and assurance in knowing that he is with us and that all power is at his disposal. In Mark chapter 4 and verse 39 and 40, it says, "He arose and rebuked the wind." Now, I know that there's all kinds of devil slayers and spirit commanders and all that stuff, but this one here, Jesus Christ, he has the capability to command the elements. He commands the elements, and when he says, "Peace be still," buddy, he went so far as to tell those that scoffed at him, he said, "You want me to tell them to be quiet?" He said, "If they would keep silent," he said, "the rocks would cry out." That's the God, folks. That's the God that is for us and with us, that sees us through. Remember when David said in the 23rd Psalm, he said, "Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For thou art with me." See, that's the providence. That's the providence of having God with us. We talk about, you know, when Roger Williams was banished out of the Massachusetts Bay College, when he left there and he came down into Rhode Island town, when he got down there, he founded a place that he called Providence. We don't talk that way a whole lot anymore. We don't talk about divine providence. But when you know that God is there and he's working, actively working in your life, that's providence. And providence is the works of God, knowing that he's in control. In John 5 and verse 17, Jesus said, "My Father worketh hitherto, and I work." He doesn't take any days off, doesn't go on vacation, isn't taking a nap. He's on the throne and he's on the job day in and day out. And he's doing it for us. He ever liveth to make intercession for us. I've seen so many times, I refuse to go, I'm not going to live a ho-hum, woe is me existence. I'm not, because I don't have to. And I don't have one. And I'm not going to create one. And so I'm not going to be dismissive of responsibilities, but I'm not going to boo-hoo about every little thing that goes wrong in my life. Amen. 1 Corinthians 12 and verse 4 and 6 says, "Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord, and there are diversities of operation, but it is the same God which worketh all in all." No matter what goes on, we'll say, "Well, this is a little different. Well, that's not quite like that." Doesn't matter. God's still God. God's still God. In Philippians 2:13, the Bible tells us, "For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure." And so that providence gives us the assurance of his protection. In verse 11, it says, "The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge." Hebrews 13 and verse 5 and 6 says, "Let not your conversation be without covetousness, and be content with such things as you have. For he hath said, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee, so that we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do unto me." Exodus 33 and verse 21 and 22, "The Lord said, behold, there is a place by me." Wouldn't it be great to just want that place? Remember James and John? Now, they kind of went a little overboard, Brother Steve. They got Jesus aside and said, "You know, can we ask you a little favor? Sure, boys, what would you like? Well, we were thinking it would be nice if we could each sit on either side of you in glory. Oh, well, that's special. Why don't you just ask to be a member of the Trinity? that's not what he's talking about, but I know this. There is a place right next to God. When the apostles, when they were around Jesus, you got one, you got Judas over there plotting how he's going to, you know, sell him for 30 pieces of silver, and then you got John laying on his breast, listening to the heartbeat of God. See, there is a place near God, and as I've said many times over the years, you are as close to God as you care to be. He said, the Lord said that there is a place by me, and thou shalt stand upon a rock, and it shall come to pass when my glory passeth by, that I will put thee in the cleft of the rock, and will cover thee with my hand while I pass by. And so, folks, as we look at this song, this encouragement, matter of fact, didn't David say in Psalm 40, in verse 1 to 3, when he was talking about, he lifted me up also out of an horrible pit, set my feet upon a rock, established my goings, put a new song in my mouth. Put a new song in my mouth. And you know what? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And if we can get our heart right with God, and if we can get to the place where we love him and trust him through all of the trials of life, we'll sing. We'll sing about this stuff. We'll sing about God is our refuge and strength. He is a very present help in trouble. And so we've seen tonight, sing the song, if you will. He's still God. He's still God. He's still God, folks. He's still God because of his power. He's still God because of his presence. And he's still God because of his peace. And there's no trial, there's no trouble that can bring us down. Not with him on our side. You know, the question was asked, who is on the Lord's side? Who is on the Lord's side? The sons of Levi, they all said, we are. We are. All I would simply say to you tonight is, choose you this day whose side you're going to be on. And so when the trials come, you know the devil's against you. You know your flesh is against you as far as living for God. You know, the world is against you. We need God. We need God. And he's on our side.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. In our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study, Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508-883-5302. For additional information about our church, please visit our website at solidrockbbc, all one word, .com.